Absolutely.
That's what happened to Lashrock.
He seems to, and he has a lot of functionality, right? Because you can sort of first pick him, and then if you need him to play a core spot, he works there. If you need to move him to a support, he's got functionality. So he's a great pick to sort of keep your opponents on their toes. On the opposite side, some folks in chat commented about this, a Tusk first pick. Is that strange to you, or do you think that that hero is strong enough to warrant that kind of pick position?
Yeah, that's what I was saying actually just now. That I saw this hero in the first phase yesterday three times with VG and Empire. He's a very aggressive support or offlane, if you want to put it that way.
Yes, that is absolutely true.
And works very well with Undying, I feel, because of the sigil plus the zombies.
Yeah, lots of slow ability to get Undying in there nice and tight to drop that Tombstone initially. Plus, we saw in a game last night where he was played very, very well, just his ability to sort of grab his cohorts and get them into the ball and sort of delay those initiations during teamfights really made them a very potent counter-initiation technique, if that makes sense. So looking forward to see what Invictus Gaming does with that Tusk. We see the Viper banned out. I'm never going to complain about seeing a Viper banned. And a Darkseer gets banned out as well.
You hate that hero.
I call him the hero that I love to hate, because don't get me wrong, when I am not feeling up to playing at my best, I pick Viper every single time. But he's just, you never get exciting plays, right? Like, as a hype caster, I never get to scream about a really great move that Viper made. It's just sort of like, Viper goes in, plink, plink, plink. So I guess he frustrates me in that capacity.
And Viper doesn't die, and Viper kills everyone. End of story.
Exactly. So literally, you could cast the game by saying, Viper goes in, team fight over. Witch Doctor grabbed to pair with the Lashrak. I like the Witch Doctor pick. He's another one that we've seen very, very popular of late. The Ag Scepter is so strong on him right now, as well as obviously the cast for the early game to stop aggression against an Undying Tusk lineup, which it looks like they may be going for those early kills with that Undying. Do you think that the cask is going to be enough to slow down those aggressive attacks, or are they going to need to pick something else up to stop the Undying aggression?
It's definitely a huge plus. You can use the Tusk after the Tusk snowballs, let's say one hero, like two or three heroes in, and you get a good bounce of that. But at the same time, Witch Doctor is a hero that you don't want the enemy team to be next to you.
Makes sense. Now, Anti-Mage is going to get banned out here. He is, so no chance of us seeing the Golden Hammers that I love so gosh darn much.
Very good versus Lashrock.
Absolutely. So they have no desire to see him come in there and hurt that Lashrak. Are there other heroes that you can expect to see countering that tanky Lashrak that's been an issue so much in these games?
Nyx Assassin is a good way because of the mana burn.
Okay, so basically anything that takes away his ability to just sort of maintain that damage output.
Nether Ward as well could be very troublesome for Lashrak before he gets BKB.
Once he gets that BKB, though, that's sort of the switch that turns him on and gets him rolling downhill. But we'll see. He could still be supporting this lineup. Team Secret has lots of options, and they are a team that does like to keep their opponents on their toes. It is, by the way, both teams, everyone here, Z is Luo. I'm sure most of you know that, but I will confirm that just for those viewers who are tuning in. So both teams bringing their A games to the LAN. Excited about this. This is a very big prize pool for tournaments right now in terms of Dota. There's over $380,000 on the line, I believe. That's gotta be pretty exciting for the teams to travel out here. Bristleback Razor gonna get picked up, so Team Secret grabs that Razor, who I feel like I don't get to see very often. What is the value of Razor in the lineup that Team Secret seems to be putting together?
The first thing when I see this hero is like lane dominance, because he beats most of the heroes 1v1 in middle lane. Let's say if you put the Razor middle lane, very few heroes can have a decent time against a hero. And secondly, back to the point where you were talking about Lashrock, he's very flexible. You can go aggro try, you can go solo mid, you can put him safe lane. There are a lot of functions of the hero.
Very, very flexible. Now we see the Keeper of the Light picked up. Dakota would be excited to see this. I have honestly been excited to see Keeper return to competitive play. He's also a hero that I just really enjoy. Honestly, I think that Blinding Light with the changes to Ags we got a while back ago is just such a powerful spell. Underrated, because, I mean, the 6-second ability to reduce, to create an 80% miss chance is just insane to me.
The neutral.
Yeah. Absolutely. No, I think that's absolutely true. And it's the new troll, but you also only have to spend a support slot on it. So it really adds a lot of functionality. I think that the ability to regen the mana of Lashrak as he's making big pushes in, this is just a really great combo to see that Lashrak working with the Keeper of the Light.
Support is sometimes underwhelming to say about this hero because he's more of like a core because of the space he actually takes up.
Absolutely. He takes up tons of space. Pushing into him is a nightmare. I mean, honestly, looking at Team Secret's lineup right now, I feel like Invictus is going to have their hands full anytime they try to push into the high ground. Even if they get a great start, Lashrak, Witch Doctor, Keeper of the Light are going to make it really tough to move up on those racks.
And not to mention, Mana Ring is fantastic against Bristleback because if he can't move around, then it's very hard for him to deal damage. And at the same time, mana is very important for a core like Bristleback.
Absolutely. So looking at the last pickup, we see Shadow Fiend grab for Invictus Gaming. So Invictus playing a hero that actually our TZ is known for doing well on. So a little bit of a nod perhaps to their opponent saying we can play this better than you as he gets ready to go to that mid, I would presume. Team Secret looking for that last spot. What do you think they're going to pick up here?
If they want to run, if they're running like Lashrak as core and Razor probably middle lane, they will need an offlane that can, like, initiating offlane, I guess.
So do you think, let's see, is Nyx Assassin still on the board? Maybe a Nyx Assassin or a hero that can use that Silver Edge to sort of break Bristleback's passive ability?
That would be actually a good, but they'll go for, mean they might actually want to go Aggro Try,
that's exciting.
I'm not sure though, or just 2-1-2, because sometimes they do Keeper plus 1 on the offlane.
Could be. So Team Secret keeping us guessing. Invictus, I would say a little more of an obvious lineup here. If they do run a Tusk Undying Disruptor tri-lane, that is going to be brutal. I think that results in a lot of potential kills here, and Secret has to be very aware of that.
I feel with the back though, that's less likely. It's more likely that they do Tusk plus Dirge Undying on the offlane. It seems like more likely because you need to help the Bristle a little at the start, so they would probably leave the Disruptor with the Bristleback on the safe lane, probably, like, I guess. Because it's like, it's new, you're not sure how Secret is gonna lane their heroes yet.
Right.
It's quite flexible.
Absolutely. And Secret, from start to finish, they've got three mids on their lineup that they can utilize at any time. So, game is in. We're gonna load up on this bad boy. I'll open up the last hit to night chart for you guys to keep an eye on. And it would not be a game of Dota without a pause to start it off. Now keep in mind, guys, this is Perfect World server, so I'm gonna do everything I can. I'm broadcasting all the way from beautiful Boston. So if we do end up in some slideshow, I will have to do some disconnect, reconnect. But I will make sure I do everything I can to give you the best quality that you can see. So stick with us if we run into any tight spots. We only had a little bit of a hiccup last night. So far, everything has been pretty gosh darn good.
Are you using VPN, dude?
Am I using VPN?
Yeah.
I think so. I'm not technologically savvy.
It usually is not a problem during the earlier games like this hour, like 10 to 12 or 1 p.m. It usually is a problem after you pass around 1 or 2 p.m. in China, because that's when the internet traffic is heavy.
That makes sense. Yeah, I think I remember I talked to the folks who brought us on board for this, and they said the VPNs would not be necessary for some reason with the Perfect World server. So I just went with that. To Lindsay over in Azubu chat, I am from the Salem area in Boston. So I will try to engage as often as I can, guys, and we'll keep rolling from there. But hey, we've got all the players lined up, so let's do some introductions while we have a little bit of time. For the Dire side, this is going to be the legendary Invictus Gaming. A team that I honestly thought when we came out of the Chinese Shuffle was going to be number one in the world potentially. It's had a little bit of a shaky start out, but really is coming on strong moving into TI. So the lineup for these guys is going to be Burning on the Bristleback. We're going to have Ferrari on the Shadow Fiend. XI, who is actually Luo, is me playing the Tusk. We're going to have Chuan on the Disruptor. And last but not least, Faith will be playing the Dirge or Undying. And I'll turn it over to you to introduce the Radiant side.
Yeah, sure. On the Radiant side, we have Secret Zai playing the Ember, Puppy on his Kotal, RTZ handling the Lashrak, Kuroki on the Witch Doctor, and lastly, we have S4 on his Razor.
So, what do you think about these lineups, Winter? As my resident expert in Pro Dota, looking at just the draft, let's take player skill out of it. Who do you think won this draft?
It's difficult to say it that way because I feel both sides have very different orientations of what they want to do in a game. Like, for example, Secret's Draft, if you just look at Secret's Draft, their draft can be very strong in the lane. At the same time, if you go towards the middle game, they can do a lot of split pushing with the Cauldron plus, you know, they have Illuminate and Lightning Storm, they can defend towers fairly easy, or Illuminate plus Plasma Field. And then the Ember and Leshra can be doing their own stuff. Or they can choose to put their lineup 5-man against IG if they feel that they have enough advantage. And for IG's side, because they have the Tusk and the first three heroes, Shadow Fiend, Undying, and Tusk, it means a lot of 5-manning, including the Disruptor as well. You want to fight when you have your ultimates, you have your tombstones, and you have your mech, obviously, on the Shadow Fiend.
So going into the start of the game here, do you think one of these teams really need to have a good laning phase more so than the other, or is it really just going to be important for both of them to come out ahead in lanes?
I think it's more important for IG to have a good laning phase, because if you look at their supports, they have Disruptor and Dirge as their supports. These two supports have a lot of they need a lot of levels basically to be effective in teamfights. Obviously, the Undying is like probably he needs like up to level 5. Around level 6, so then he's a very annoying hero in the team fight because of the tombstone. Disruptor, obviously the most important part is the ultimate.
Absolutely. Alright, so we will keep an eye on that, see if IG can maintain the lead in the laning phase. We still honestly don't really know how these lanes are going to match up. Now, I will say that IG has had a little bit of additional time due to this pause to try and figure out what's going on in Secret's head. But as of now, I still haven't quite put my finger on it. Secret with a lot of options and knowing these guys, something up their sleeve. We saw in the Summit, which is the last major tournament that they played in, that I was able to watch, that they did a really good job of setting the stage for taking on VG Gaming, who looked unbeatable in that tournament at the start, and then just came into that late phase game and really showed that not only were they prepped and ready, but they were executing phenomenally well. We'll see if they carry that into this tournament.
Yeah, if you look at the item selection already, you probably might know the lanes. If RTZ is going for a Null Talisman and 2 Branch, he has Observer Ward. His supports probably would pull him Tangles after, and the Razor is going for more side lane items. Ring of Protection and a set of Tangles and a Solve, 2 Branch. So it seems like it's more likely S4 will be on the side lanes.
And Arteezy will be taking that Leshrac to the mid position. So a mid Leshrac, we like that. He gets the fast levels. He gets some good farm early on. Do you think that that's the right choice, putting the Leshrac in the mid over the Razor in that position?
Oh, it depends what they want to do though, because Leshrac mid, like you say, you can control the runes and move around to try and gank, and Razor, you can use the hero to, he's much stronger in lane dominating, and Leshrac it's like you just want to get fast levels on him and get a couple of runes. If you get a good rune, it's easy to gank with your nukes.
Alright, so it does look like we're going to start to lay out here on the runes. We got 4 to the top from the guys on Secret, and IG going to spread out as they head out to their respective locations. Top rune will be uncontested by Invictus as they head down towards the bottom with 2, and they will be seen by Zai, who will back away. Nice ward already up here from IG. So they're going to have good vision of the rune in a spot that is going to be very unlikely to be dewarded in the early game.
I see. And they actually going to lane Witch Doctor plus Razor top, so the lane would be this lane against a Bristleback lane. They want the Razor, basically they want the Razor to go to the Bristleback's lane, because Razor is very good against a melee core. And Witch Doctor plus Razor against, let's see the lane. They're going to go up against a tri lane, because there was a ward at bottom placement that you mentioned, IG earlier. They saw the Ember at bottom, so they know that the Razor will be at top. And they realize if they have Disruptor plus Bristleback against Razor plus 1, it's going to be a very hard lane for the Bristle to farm. So they're sending an extra hero top. They were going to do a dual lane bottom, but they changed their mind because of how Secret are.
Excellent flexibility by IG shown there to make the change. Luo having a little bit of trouble though, up against Zai, already dropping pretty low. He's got 3 tangos left, but gonna start to eat through that regen pretty quickly here. Who has the advantage in that bottom lane?
I think based on hero matchup, probably Ember would have a slight edge, but because Luo didn't, he went for the boots item, like the standard offlane item, and Zai has Taoshu and protection, so Zai has better laning items, I would say.
So Zai
Luo was expecting, I guess, a 2 hero or 3 hero at least matchup at bottom.
So Zai with a little bit of an advantage, both in hero pick as well as build, it sounds like, and is going to be working to get that, really expedite that over Luo down there on the bottom. Up on the top, where we're looking at a try versus a try, so that aggressive try lane definitely coming out from Team Secret. The harassment already starting. Chuan going to go ahead and build into that Thunder Strike right out of the gate. One of those early spells that's just so strong for harassing your opponents, trying to keep them in line as they push Kuroki and S4 back towards the lane. We do see a rotation by Puppy towards the middle, going to go ahead and manage that rune at the same time that Luo will be doing that on the bottom. Arteezy versus Ferrari mid. Tell me a little bit about this matchup.
It's really difficult for either side to get kills unless someone makes a mistake, because it's like, I'm going to use I'm Lash, I'm pushing with Lightning Storm on top lane.
Top lane looks like they do have a little bit of an engagement. Faith will fall backwards, not interested in going in on that.
I think they got the neutral KS, so I'm not sure. It's going to be big. Oh, who got the last hit on that? I didn't see. I think it was the Disruptor. Got a lot of experience.
He is... Let's see. He's sitting at the top of level 1, and we've got Razor at 2 right now. In fact, all the supports, everyone on the side of Secret is 2 up in this lane. So did a good job of getting over there and stopping the pull on that camp, I believe.
Yeah, going back to the middle lane, I think it's mostly going to be like Raze and Lightning Storm to spam the wave out, but I would say Shadowfiend would have a better matchup as soon as he hits like level 5 because of the damage.
Absolutely. So that should be a pretty interesting matchup. We'll keep an eye on it as the CST plays out. And right now, Ferrari keeping pretty much even with Arteezy as they go back-to-back. But like you said, Ferrari looking for that level 5 to really pick up that damage output. And we'll keep the camera on the top lane, as I expect, where that will show us a little bit of action. Down the bottom, Zai makes a nice move on Luo, burning him down pretty low. Luo's got to get back, has no regen left. Zai also out of regen, and he's going to be down pretty low at 120, has to play very carefully. Now we see Puppy goes through, decides that he wants to take over this creep camp, ruins the pull, and the Dire has gone through and dewarded the camp blocks. So look at all of these sentry wards here by the Dire to try and keep control of their own jungle and their own pull camp.
If you look at the last hit counter right now, Razor has 10, and Razorback actually is doing better than a Razor, which was what I did not expect, because they are... Bristleback and Undying double melee against a 3 range, but I guess Bristleback and Undying really good against multiple heroes because of how their spells work. DK against multiple heroes and Quill Spirit as well.
They all seem like they've been doing a very good job of managing the creep equilibrium and keeping it risky for S4 to move forward.
They were able to make a couple of pulls previously.
Absolutely. The two points in Tombstone, the fact that Bristleback can go ahead and stack those quills and Disruptor can come in at any point he wants to with the point in Glimpse really does put a huge threat for S4, as he has to be very careful in this lane. And I think that is definitely hurting the CS's ability to try and manage those last hits here. Back to the middle, we'll check in with Arteezy, who's at 24-3. We do see Shadowfiend headed back to base. And it's got a nice, it's not headed back to base, just a huge pullback on that camp way behind the tower. Ferrari has the brown boot sitting on 200 gold, and it looks like the bottle as well as his circlet are on his way out to him right now. But here's a rotation. We see a smoke, Kuroki and Puppy looking to get something done. Head down towards the middle lane. Meanwhile, up on the top, S4 is going to show some aggression, try to convince them that they're still around. And Kuroki is going to be on standby as Puppy searches about, trying to see if they can't find the missing Chuan. Chuan is coming.
Yeah, he's going to... They notice something is wrong. Supports are not at top.
So they do move in, puts out the cask, big play. Disruptor's gonna lock in Kuroki. Kuroki's gonna get stuck with 430. Ferrari doing some serious damage. One more right click will finish the job. And down he goes, and it could be Puppy as well. Puppy came in, and a huge rotation by Luo confirms the double kill, double damage rune did not hurt. And they get a beautiful play in the mid to start them off right. Nice work by Invictus Gaming.
Yeah, that was just a really good heads up play because they had a ward on the lane at top and they noticed the supports weren't around, so they immediately moved one of the supports to actually scout out so that the mid player, the Shadowfiend in this case, if he knows the position of the supports, he doesn't have to play under so much pressure.
So they did very, very, very well. Ferrari off of that hits level 7. We still got Lashrak sitting at 6, so not only did he get to that 5 to seize the advantage, but off of those kills, he got a good level jump on Arteezy. That's going to make that position significantly harder to deal with. S4 sitting at level 4, and his CS at 22-5, burning at 23-7.
They're going to make a play at top with the Glimpse.
Here comes the move. They drop the tombstone. They want to go for the charge. The slow is there. Ferrari's closing, but a bit too slow. And it looks like they may get out of this one. The glimpse comes backwards. Nice cast by Cottle. Faith dropping low. Not enough. Down goes the Witch Doctor, and away walks Invictus Gaming. A nice play. The power of the tombstone as they come through and get that kill.
Yeah, it's just a lot of synergy between tombstone plus glimpse. Tombstone will force you to run away, and glimpse will bring you back.
Absolutely, and they did a good job of waiting to the last possible second to use that glimpse just to maximize the damage output. Let everyone get in position. Shadow Fiend rotates in, going on Zai. Zai jumps away. Will he get to safety, though, as the chase is on? The ice shards are there. Not going to go after him. Luo content to go back to lane and enjoy some free last hits. Zai coming back, though, has got the bottle. Healing back up. Looks like he wants to go. Going to charge in on Luo. Luo's got no help. He's dropping low. Can Zai finish the deal? Doesn't have enough mana.
He got interrupted when he was using his bottle charge. Otherwise, he would have enough mana for another chains.
And that would have been the end of him. So a good, unfortunate that it got interrupted, but lucky for Luo as he heads back to base to get those heals. Bristle on top starting to have a lot more trouble with S4 as he's doing a good job of zoning him out now that those supports have been rotated away. And immediately Faith and Chuan see the issue, pop a smoke and head right back towards the top lane. Is this the way that you want to see these supports played for IG, constantly in motion?
Yeah, they need to make sure that their lanes, like the cores, are having a good time in their lanes, at the same time getting levels on themselves. Let's see their position of the creep wave. They're probably going to wait for, 8-minute rune.
Alright, so the rune comes out. We got a little bit of a slide jump, but we're going to stick around because it looks like Arteezy came in to try and get it. He's on the run, gets glimpsed backwards, hit with the tombstone. They're on the chase. Arteezy dropping low. Do they have enough to stop him? Faith not interested in going back. He wants to keep the chase going, and they end up getting the kill on Arteezy, but the rest of the crew has shown up and the chase is on. Faith gonna try to kite away, make a little bit of space by going into the jungle. He drops pretty low. S4 finishes the job. Now it's Chuan going back towards the tower, hit and taken down, and that ends up being they got the Arteezy kill, but the cost seems a bit high.
I think it's still okay, because if you look at the map, IG still, even though they lost two supports just to kill the mid, but Bristle was farming top because of Secret Force to help out Arteezy. And bottom lane, Zai was also farming.
Zai makes a move, hit with the Walrus Punch, comes in, throws out the Shackle. Now we see, go straight into Snowball. The TP comes out by Dirge, wants to come in, goes for the attack. In he goes, but it's not going to be enough. They lose the Tusk. And Dirge TP's in for not anything, and now he's going to have to back away. So I'm going to try to take this chance, and oh no, it looks like the slideshow fixed, so we'll stick around and avoid the reconnect as long as possible. Are you getting any slideshow, or is it coming from my side?
No, it's fine with me because I'm using a VPN. Usually it's fine during the morning.
Alright, so burning head-to-head with Kuroki and S4 up on the top lane as S4 starts to work his way back into contention. With the bristle back in terms of his CS, let's pull up the net worth stack chart so you guys can see where they're sitting right now. Shadow Fiend at 4,000, Lashrek at 3.9, so keeping pace with each other. Now we're going to see a smoke pop by Ferrari and Luo as they rotate towards that top lane. Kuroki pushing in, S4 going into the tower. This could be trouble for him as rotation comes from the back, goes into the snowball from hell. It catches, it punches, it dices, slices, and makes pizza pie as they get the double kill up on the top lane. Kuroki going into the woods. But what can he do other than just buy a little bit of time?
Yeah, it was just a very, very good small game, because they were showing one hero in middle, they were showing the disruptor middle, and they were showing the dodge at bottom. So both of the supports of IG were on the map. That's why Secret felt they were safe at top, but they were rotating with because you would think that the Shadow Fiend was jungling usually when he's off the map.
Alright, now it looks like Zai looking for something. He's going to go ahead and find Luo in the jungle, rotating towards the mid as he uses that invis room to track his movements, waiting for some backup. In comes Lashrak, going to hit the high ground stun. Luo goes into the ball, though, before it happens. Zai puts up the escape plan, starts to hit him with the right click. Walrus Punch going to come out. Zai should jump away. Comes Faith Tombstone, and he will jump to safety. Tombstone wasted.
That was rather unfortunate. If you look at the disruptor, he's like 10 experience off level 6. Mm. He would have killed the Ember with his ultimate.
So lucky for Zai as he made his escape plan and was able to execute it, because Disruptor just a little bit off of the XP pace he needed to get that kill. Gold lead overall is still pretty much even. XP slightly favoring IG, but not by much. Still really anybody's game. IG up 6-3, but is the kill count really that relevant with the way this game's going?
Not really though, because of the fact that the way Secret placed their lanes and IG, they weren't really able to stack up Ancients for the pistol back because the supports were mostly occupied and bottom lane was 1v1. So as the Tufts, you don't really want to move around to just keep stacking Ancients when you can. When you are 1v1 matchup against an Ember, you want to stay in the lane as much as possible. So the Ancients are not stacked for the pistol. Usually during the mid game, you see pistol back like surge up in net worth because of the Ancient stacks, but it's not going to happen this game.
Looks like that is going to be a mech finished up on the Shadow Fiend. So Ferrari with a little more survivability, a little bit of extra push potential. But he does get hit by the Arteezy stun right away, shocked by lightning. And now he's got to take off. But here comes the Cavalry. It's Faith and the crew as they show up. Nice knockback from Puppy. Will it be enough? The Tombstone comes down. Silent goes out. Arteezy up. Arteezy down. Now Lua wants to make a chase. No one willing to leave the Tombstone zone, though. And they stick around. That Lestrat kill well worth everything spent to get it. And Arteezy definitely having a tough start here in this match.
It was that high ground vision as well. IG knew how many heroes were behind, so they were confident that they could take a fight, and they sent up reinforcement a lot earlier. And top lane, Burning seems like he's gonna go down here. He's surrounded.
Up on top. So that is Bristle. Not going to be able to take anybody with. The Mesopor getting a little low, but the ultimate just too strong. And the top tower does look like it should go down, as there are no responses coming out from Invictus to stop it.
They had like, I think, 2 or 3 heroes TP mid just now. I wasn't paying attention. That's why they couldn't. They were moved around the map by Secret, even though they lost the last shot previously, but...
Arteezy under attack again down the bottom. Wants to go on Chuan, but out comes the Snowball. Gonna hit him, stun him, lock him in place. Arteezy not interested in walking away, though. Wants to keep going. Chuan's gotta fall back. Walrus punch to the face. Down goes Arteezy. So did not want to run for the tower. Tried to get the kill on Chuan and ended up costing him his life as Ferrari rotates in from the back.
Yeah, nice, he done. That few deaths in a row is gonna set him back very far from his bloodstone.
Well, he was keeping pace with the Shadow Fiend in terms of farm about 2 minutes ago, and now he's at 4.7 compared to the 6.5, and that's going to be very, very tough for him. In comes Zai, goes ahead, does a nice sleight of fist, gets the stun up on Chuan. He's going to drop down to the rotation from S4. Here comes the rolling ball, going to crack into Zai. Zai in some trouble, gets stunned, gets knocked out. He's going to go down with the ulti from Ferrari. S4 has to try to get out of this one. Ice shards push him away from the tower as they will continue to just wail on it. And this should be a lost bottom tower. S4 pops the ulti, wants to go in. Burning sees it coming, pops some quills, and now we should see IG. They're going to back away or engage. They decide to engage. Luo goes in deep, catches Arteezy, pops him up in the air. He goes down again! Puppy has to run away. S4 is in deep, no one else around. Does get the Shadow Fiend, but he's being chased from the back. He's slowed, hits the mech, heals himself up. Here comes the Sleight of Fist, hits everyone. S4 still very low. He's gonna live as he gets away. Zyrie can have it, takes out Luo, takes out two. The Bristle back down.
That was a really good buyback from the Ember. This is one of the few things that the Ember can do early to mid game.
Buy back and get right back into that thing, and he did, and it really turned the way it went.
Yeah, he got 2 kills, otherwise they would have... I would say it's a very worthy buyback for the goal and experience that he got. And obviously saving the team fight for his team, otherwise they would have lost.
It would have been devastating. Now let's talk about that Lestrak. Also goes down again. That puts Lestrak at a kill count right now. He's 1-4. How does that affect the synergy of a Lestrak in this game? Because don't you think a Lestrak is someone who needs to get kind of a decent start and become that sort of mid-game snowball?
It's a very, like you mentioned, snowball type of hero. So it's important that he gets a good start or a semi-decent one. But at this pace, he would probably get his Bloodstone at maybe sub 20, I would say. I mean, it's still acceptable. It's just very, very important to make sure that the Lestrak doesn't get a lot of Bloodstone charges early if you're playing against a Lestrak.
Right, the line. The way this game is going, is IG in a firm advantage because of the Lestrak situation?
It also depends when are they gonna get the Roche. Not only the Lestrak situation, or middle lane.
Oh, they come in. Big engagement. Nash the stun. Gets the double. In comes the Witch Doctor Alti. Ripping Faith apart. Arteezy getting low. So is Luo. Faith manages to get out, but he's going to back off. Luo going to fall back. They lost Arteezy again in that engagement, and IG withdraws. So IG has made it a point to target Arteezy in these fights, and it is working out for them as Arteezy has dropped from one time on the top of that net worth stack to fourth place.
And he's a hero, like Leshrac is a hero that's always in the middle of the fight, and against a disruptor, when you go into the middle of the fight and you try to get out, there's always glimpse, so you're never actually getting out. And I was going to say that IG's lineup, it depends on when they're going to get the Roche, because they have the Ghoul from the Bristol back, which he hasn't skilled yet, and Shadowfiend minus armor aura. So when they get the Aegis, they're going to be able to take towers much better with the Undying Tombstone, because if you have Aegis and Undying Tombstone, it's going to be difficult to defend if you're secret.
That makes sense. And as far as tower counts go, it does look like IG a little bit slower on the push,
yeah,
but just waiting.
Usually
for
that. You don't say that when you have Keeper of the Light, but because they have Snowball to actually just find the Keeper and just go in and kill the Keeper first, so having the Keeper doesn't ensure that you're going to defend all your towers in this sort of lineup that IG have.
Keeper is about halfway towards that Ag Scepter, by the way, so it looks like he's going towards that as fast as he possibly can. And should have that up by what I would say about 34 minutes into this thing.
34? Yeah. Oh, you mean 24?
24 is what I meant. I'm sorry, 34 would be ridiculous. So it does feel about 24. That'll be a nice time for him to have it, and it should make these pushes a little more difficult. Meanwhile, on the top lane, Ferrari and Zai stare each other head to head. Neither one wants to take that fight, and they both just back away, not knowing where the rest of the crews are. Taking a look at Vision on the map right now. If we open up Radiant Vision, they got a little bit going to the Dire jungle, but not too much. On the opposite side, Dire about the same position, so nobody with a firm vision control in terms of the map right now. Well, maybe now they are, as IG goes ahead and dewards the Radiant Ward on the Roche pit.
Zai is going. He has chosen to go for a blink as his first item on Ember. I mean, we see this item on Ember a lot, but not as a first item.
All right. So let's take a look at those items. Anything besides? So the BKB just finished up on Shadowfiend. Pretty big get for them. And then we see a smoke. So we'll cover the smoke as we talk about this.
Medallion and smoke.
And Medallion and Smoke. So they deward, they get the Medallion, they go straight in, and they start to push up on that Roche.
Oh, the Spirit's counter there.
Spirit comes in, sees them, they're all waiting for their chance to possibly go in and counter. Kuroki on standby. Will they stop this? Can they stop this?
It's difficult though, because Undying Tombstone on the Roche area, you know where it's gonna go. It's gonna go on the high ground, and you can't actually hit it, so it's a significant advantage for IG, but the Ember might try to steal the Aegis though, I'm not sure.
That seems like the only possibility is Arteezy up pushing the top. Ferrari gonna go ahead and just grab the Aegis and they'll walk away. No contest whatsoever. Immediate TP by Birding to make sure that tower is not pushed in any way, shape, or form. We see that Puppy and Zai are gonna be working the jungle. Puppy trying to make sure that he gets that Ag Scepter finished up as quickly as possible.
Yeah, they're gonna need that ASAP. They are not gonna be able to take any more head-on fights, so they're gonna have to count on the Keeper to make sure that he's the one buying a lot of space and time for the rest of the heroes to split push and farm.
Absolutely.
Their plan is mostly going to try and force IG to split up, not group as five, and they find pickoffs with the early blink from the Ember.
And that does depend on getting those last couple items up, so that's why we see them hanging out in the jungle, getting as much farm as they can. Puppy is going to TP to the mid lane. Pops the ulti.
Does he have another piece? Oh yeah, he has another piece of his item. Yes, so it's 300 shot.
So he gets a wave or two, and then he'll be right on track to go ahead and get it. And then his permanent ulti, so he may as well use it now. All right, Zai gonna go ahead and bottle up a regen rune. He's gotta be pretty happy about that. Rotation by Kuroki to get the rune. Comes down, sees it's gone, says, that's a shame.
Yeah, they need to get as much offensive wards. Like, the two wards that Secret have right now, they see a lot deep into enemy territory. It's important to have this sort of wards against five-man lineups, so you know when and where they're gonna push as five, and you can react by splitting your heroes all over the map. Like, you see before this what Secret is doing, they have S4 at top lane, constantly occupying top. They have Kotl plus either Leshrac defending middle, and Zai is always alone on the other side of the map. So they are always having all the lanes push out, try to slow IG from getting that five-man death ball onto your face with the Aegis.
And it seems like that plan is so far working to keep them in this. In fact, they're up ahead. Their gold lead's about 2,500. XP is at 2,000. So yeah, Secret, setting a good pace.
Yeah, just using... It's pretty similar with one of the games yesterday. I can't remember which. I think it was Cloud9 game. They had this Kotal matchup lineup where they did the same thing. They were just always constantly using the map better because of the recall that Kotal has. Mm. You can have someone on the other side of the map while he just summons him in, just in case they need to use him to fight. So all the heroes get better farm across the map.
So while it has felt like the pace has favored IG, when we look at those gold leads, we see that it's not necessarily that way. Yeah, here's the big rotation. IG wants to get back into this. They want to take the lead. They're going to see Kuroki. Puppy walks into it, gets hit, rocked, and knocked down pretty hard. Mischance not going to be that big.
That was a really important play they needed to make. You need to wrap around if you're against a Kotal before you take the tower. Otherwise, if you just knock out the tower, you're not going to be... You're gonna be greeted with a few unfriendly illuminates and your creep wave are gone.
So they do go in, they get the kill, and they're gonna take the mid tower. Down on the bottom lane, however, they lost the tier 1, and it looks like the tier 2 is under some serious onslaught by Zai, with backup from Arteezy waiting in the wings. Arteezy goes into the woods.
This is not an easy kill. This is not an easy kill at all. They need to time their spells perfectly with the silence from Disruptor. Radiant
middle tower. So they are going to come in, stand him down. Arteezy looks like he might want to go in here. Throws up the lightning, goes ahead and hits Faith, but Faith wants to engage, puts down the tombstone. Silence is there, Arteezy locked in. In comes Zai, going to start bouncing around. Immediately we see the snowball come out. He's going to charge straight at Arteezy. Everyone's there. He's taking a lot of damage. He will go down. Faith dropping low. S4 putting in some serious work, and they will lose that. Burning dropping now as well. S4 doing everything he can to try and take out that Bristle. Chuan turns back around. S4 is gonna hit by the shards, goes for the TP away. In comes Zai, gets the stun on Chuan. Chuan's gonna drop down, and now the chase is on as they want to kill themselves some Burning. Can Burning get away? He cannot. He's hit with the stun. Zai with the right clicks, one more will do the job. Not gonna happen. Heals up, and now it's Zai that could be in some trouble. He's gonna jump away, goes after the Remnant, gets to safety, hits the TP, should be able to get out of this one as the ice shards miss.
Yeah, there was even a real recall there just to make sure that he gets out.
So that was a 2-for-2, a Lestrak and a Razor for a Dirge and a Disruptor.
Definitely IG came out on top, and they defended their tier 2. They traded two supports for two important heroes on the side of Secret.
It seemed like that was a very aggressive play by Arteezy to engage underneath the tower like that. Was that a forced engagement because IG spotted him out and made the move first, or
not really? It was I felt it was just like because you dropped the tombstone. He dropped the tombstone, and tombstone so happened to break the trees, and they saw him because the tombstone break the trees, not because they knew he was there. That's what I felt.
Alright, looks like they go on Faith. Faith gonna go ahead, pops the ulti, throws down the tombstone, but he's got nowhere to go. Damn. He's gonna get picked off.
He just wanted to get vision for his team on the jungle.
And now,
but unfortunately, he ran into so many heroes.
Yeah, ran into an entire firing squad as they rip him to shreds, and Secret continues to be in control of the gold right now. 3,000 XP is 3,000 in their favor as well. So while the kill count shows that maybe IG is doing better, Secret seems to be in control of this match. They're on pace. That Acceptor up on Puppy has made a huge difference in some of these fights. And while EG did stand their ground on the bottom, we see a smoke as Secret's not quite done yet.
I think it was in range of that observer from IG.
So IG sees it, and that would presumably make sense as to why they fell back towards their tower. So we see a big rotation from Secret. They're going hunting, but they're not going to find anyone just yet.
They're going to go all the way bottom, I feel.
He's the only hero they could see, so for them it makes sense they go after Ferrari.
He's gonna just BKB and TP out. There's nothing to cancel his TP.
Alright, so in they go. Puppy gonna lead in first, makes a move, moves in, throws him around. He's gonna go ahead and pop the ultimate, taking a lot of damage. Can the TP go through in time? It does, just barely gets away.
It was so close that he was really confident that he could drop his ulti and get out, like just do some damage and buy some time. But in the end, it almost cost him his life.
Almost cost him his life. That Witch Doctor ward put in some serious work. But like you said, Ferrari puts up the ulti, pops the BKB, and TPs to safety. Just gave us a little bit of a heart attack as he did it. Meanwhile, we go back to the mid where Puppy's leading another charge. Going in for Burning, puts up the mana leak, but they get the stun on Chuan. Chuan's isolating gets pulled into the snowball. Snowball on the chase for Arteezy. Arteezy hits with the Wallace Punch. Silence is going to come out, buys a little bit of space. He's on the run. He's going to go down. Luo taking some damage now, but the whole team is there. They catch S4. S4 goes down. That's the double. IG feeling pretty good right now as they keep the push going. We will see the disrupt, the glimpse backwards, and again, Witch Doctor is going to be picked off. A triple kill for IG that'll allow them to push right down this lane. Here comes the Illuminate, and they actually see it coming basically and get out of the way. Nicely done, and this will mean a tower for them.
Snowball.
Snowball chase all the way in. Luo and Fade get knocked back into the tower. Luo taking some damage. In comes Zai, wants to make a move, wants to make them pay for their hubris. Now Faith on the run along with Luo. They are going to get glimpsed backwards, so that is their forced escape, and they don't get the tower.
That was a little lucky that Tuss didn't die. He didn't get hit by the
and
chains.
Now Faith could be in some trouble. Zai comes in and gets him, catches him with those searing chains, but the chase isn't over as he continues to try to chase these guys down. So Zai ends up getting a good turnaround.
Yeah, the Disruptor still has a glimpse though. If he chases, they can just glimpse him away. You can see from the last fight, IG are much stronger as S5. Burning is going to get chains up here, but there's backup nearby though, so I think he's fine.
Just a little bit of harass, but they will basically tell him, we are not scared of you. That triple kill did not push us back, and you need to be careful. So that works. Burning has to go back to lane. Well, look at this. Zai, playing aggressive, puts up the safety remnant, and we'll go ahead and push in behind the tower to continue to harass. Finds Chuan. This may not be a harassment. Almost a kill, but Chuan, fast on the glimpse, sends him back. Sorry, go ahead.
The last fight, it's very evident that if it's a direct head-on fight with the Tusk snowballing in with the Undying, it's very hard for Secret to take a fight right now.
Gold Lead, by the way, was pretty heavily in Secret's corner. That triple and the push did pull it a little bit closer to IG, but Secret back in control of it after the turnaround kill on Dirge. 12-17 is the kill count, but that by no means shows the way that this game seems to be going. Battle Fury is up on the Ember Spirit, as well as he's got himself a Blink Dagger there. Bloodstone finished up on the Shrak. Yule Scepter almost actually finished as well, just waiting to come to him. BKB finished up on the Razor, so that'll be coming out on the Courier as well. Sans Yasha on the Shadow Fiend, Sans Yasha on the Bristleback, and those are the major items that are really sort of in play right now.
The next major item, I think, is the BKB on the Bristleback. He got controlled so hard by Puppy the last fight. Mana Leak and Blinding Light. It's so annoying as a Bristleback. Mm-hmm.
Can't do much, can't hit, can't run, can't move, and put himself in a frustrating spot. So that BKB gonna come out, and gonna let him get a little more involved in the next big battle. What are we looking for right now at this point in the game? Is Secret happy to go back and farm? What is IG trying to accomplish? What are we looking for in the next 5 or 10 minutes?
Secret are just, I think, mostly looking to get more items. Because they have a lineup that farms better, that uses the map better, so they're gonna look to try and stall out the game and make sure that they get farm across their heroes, a lot of farm across their heroes, so they're gonna try to take the game late, and IG is gonna hit a timing probably with the Nyx. I think the Nyx Aegis plus a BKB on the Bristle before they try and siege again.
So talk to me a little bit about Kuroki's build right now. The Witch Doctor build where he's got 4 into his cask, 1 in Restoration, and 2 into Death Ward with nothing in Maledict. Is that a common build on a Witch Doctor?
I think Maledict is really good against Bristle, but in this sort of situation where it's Undying, Tusk, and Bristle, like I mentioned, remember during the draft, I said it's going to be difficult for Witch Doctor because they can get up close and personal to Kuroki very easily with their lineup. So getting points, you're not going to be able to use the Maledict. So getting stats is a good choice here for the Witch Doctor. Plus his item selection, it's kind of difficult for him to get the Axe Scepter in this game because the Cortal will be taking up a core position farm as well. So he's choosing to get the Glimmer Cape, which is a much cheaper option, and it's very helpful for his team and himself.
Alright, it does look like they're thinking about going Roche here, so IG is just going to walk in slow, not interested in stealth. Double damage are going to come out to help out with that.
Yeah. And by the way, Toffees, that's a BKB already on the Bristle. BKB plus Aegis on Shadow Fiend, I guess? Yeah, Aegis on Shadow Fiend, they're gonna push. Yeah, they would want to take care of their lanes first, and Secret would try to make sure that all the lanes are pushed. Just look at the map again. So Secret are placing once more their heroes across the map, and IG are gonna have to deal with it before they try to use up their Aegis and fight Mantic more.
Makes sense. So they got, and Secret doing a good job, like you said, of executing that strategy, keeping IG on their toes, making them move around the map the way that Secret wants them to move.
They have one very deep ward here as well, the one towards the middle. So this is going to be very helpful in understanding when and where they can split push.
Bait finds Poppy though, they see him in there, or do they?
They actually did not see, did not see him.
Huh. So I thought maybe he TP'd away, he's just going to hide out in the woods. Now he's going to come out and the tombstone will spot him maybe, finally.
Okay.
So there it is. Now we see zombies spawning and Burning's like, aha, there you are. But they don't have a stun and he'll just TP to safety. So nicely played by Puppy to hold it in that spot and not get freaked out. And unfortunately for IG, they missed out on a chance to pick up a nice kill.
At the very least, he made Dandai use the tombstone. So that's a pretty long cooldown. So they have to wait for that before they go again.
Alright, let's look at the gold where it's about dead even. XP is about dead even as well. So the tale of the tape is that this game is fairly evenly matched in terms of overall collections. Now, if we pull up the net worth stack chart, you're going to see that Shadow Fiend is carrying the lion's share of Lion's net worth at Dire's net worth at 17.6k. Bristleback not far from his counter at 13.3, but Radiant sort of spreading the gold out across the team.
Yeah, it's just a this is a result of the way they are approaching the game, I'd say.
And is that, do you think that that's going to be detrimental to Secret as Shadow Fiend starts to pull so far ahead? Or do think that's really going to work out in their favor if they've got four heroes?
Top lane, Burning.
Let's look at that. Burning being chased by Zai. Zai wants to go. He does have the Searing Chain. He's going to go ahead and put him up at the BKB. Freeze Burning as he walks away. Lua looks like he thought about re-engaging, decides it's not worth it. Here comes Ferrari, though. And he's just going to be here to make play backup, farms the camp, and they will disengage.
That was a really important event that happened for Secret because it was a 10-second BKB, so it was a huge deal. And by that small move, even though it seemed like they didn't gain anything, but in theory, they bought themselves time. That is the most important thing Secret needs right now, time.
Absolutely, they are doing a good job. But that 10-second BKB is going to be really, really
crucial. Going back to the point where you were talking about Shadow Fiend being so far, but it's going to reach a point where at a certain, there's gonna be limitations because you only have 6 slots and a moon shot to consume. So Secret's lineup is more based on getting everyone farmed. So there's gonna be a limitation to what Shadow Fiend can do as the game progresses because there's only so much items you can buy.
That is true. Ferrari is getting very fat right now. That Daedalus to go along with the BKB, the Sanjasha, and the mech. And we'll see a TP to mid to defend the push that's going on here. And Secret's doing a good job of looking for trades. Basically, a tower goes down, top tier 1, and there is a deny by Tusk, so a good deny.
That was a really good play by Secret because they understood that they saw the Disruptor on top, and Disruptor didn't have a teleport score. Because if you're trying to push like this, the most important target to notice on the map is the Disruptor, because he's the only one, if you look at IG's lineup, he's the only one that can actually, plus the Snowball obviously, that can catch you guys off when you're trying to, because usually teams, you try to force someone back, and then you back off. But when there's a Disruptor, you cannot make that play, because Glimpse is very long range. But because they knew that the Disruptor didn't have a TP scroll, they went for that play.
And they did a very good job of getting a good exchange. Yes, it was denied, but it's still great for them in terms of getting those towers down, map control.
It's time again. Time bought for the team.
Ferrari looks like he wants to make something happen. Zai is just going to back away. And Secret doing a good job of being slippery and just staying out of the grasps of IG. Now IG rotating around. Looks like they see Arteezy. They want to try to catch him out of position. Killing him would be wonderful for them. But he's going to get called by Coddle and off he goes.
This must be so frustrating, Top Leafs. They have Boots of Travel on Lesha and recall.
Oh, that's got to be infuriating. So up to the top they go. Engagement comes in. Yule Scepter gonna start it off. Stun's gonna hit immediately. Burning takes the full shot of the Illuminate. Pops that 9-second BKB and runs.
They did it again. They forced the BKB and he actually has a blink as well. They didn't see the blink.
Yeah. So he's got quite a bit. Daedalus, by the way, recipe already purchased up. So we should see that coming out relatively soon. And they're gonna push up on this top tower. And I don't know that IG can come in and stop it.
Yeah, they're executing their game plan very, very well. On Secret side.
Absolutely.
Middle lane,
we see Arteezy going in, puts up the Yule Scepter, wants to go on Chuan, gets out the silence, and he gets glimpsed right back to the rest of his crew. So, nice survival play by Chuan, but that does mean that his ultimate is down.
Radiant's bottom tower is under
I mean, it's
attack.
Not the end of the world. It's not like Black Hole or Ravage. It's true. Like, what, 70 seconds? Or 80 seconds at level 2, so not the biggest deal.
Radiant's
he's gonna get it up
attack.
On cooldown again in the next minute. And his team is not in any position to push any lane, if you look at the position of the creep wave. So
Radiant's
it's not a big deal for his team. But they do need, I think they do need a gem. Oh, they have a gem on Undying. Yeah. I was saying that they're gonna need a gem to make sure that there's no vision. Because if your IG, the way Secret are moving around, it feels like Secret knows where your heroes are, so they're moving
right.
accordingly. So you need to get all those wards out, so Secret can't do that.
Alright, so and it is Secret got those very strong wards here on the Dire side, looking deep into vision, whereas Dire sitting on some pretty defensive wards at the moment. Up on top, Burning gonna go ahead and just farm the jungle as they try to keep pace with the basically catch-up of what Secret's been doing in terms of evening out the farm.
At some point, they're going to need maybe a hex, I'd say, because if you're playing against what Secret is doing, you need to catch and kill the person that's speed-pushing and being annoying.
So, somebody did just bring this up in chat. Interestingly enough, Secret has picked up a 5k gold lead all while IG was holding an Aegis.
Yeah, it's just down to the fact that how Secret were playing the game. Like, they were just making sure that they are utilizing the resources much better. And here comes a catch on the Ember. Oh, dear.
They're going, but a nice play by Zai. Blinks and jumps to safety. Smoke is wasted.
He breaks the smoke, and again, just look at the map. There's someone. Oh, there's always someone pushing out the lanes.
Mm-hmm. And now they want Arteezy, blinks in, tries to go for the chase, using that immortal animation to gain ground. But will it be enough? Arteezy awful fast with that Yules. Gonna go ahead and Yules himself, and off he goes.
What a nice play there. Even though the Shadowfiend didn't raise him, but it was a really nice, like, preemptive play that would make sure that he got recalled. Mm-hmm. That was a really good play from the Lechra. From Arteezy,
making sure the recall goes through. Puppy gets him back, and once again, the split push back underway as Arteezy straight to bottom.
This is so infuriating to play against. It's like playing against a Broodmother, but worse.
But worse, because his bot is still on cooldown, so the second that they rotate to try and stop him,
and
back to top lane.
He kills the creep way faster than a Broodmother, and he kills the tower sort of as fast as you kill tower, as a Broodmother kill towers.
And he doesn't have to worry about...
And he's going back top! Look at this!
He doesn't have to worry about losing his spiders.
They just move the entire team top, they try to kill Arteezy, they recall him bottom, and they move towards bottom and he TP'd back to top.
So Arteezy literally making IG's life a living hell as they go. They just got to bottom and the push is back up. Meanwhile, the rest of the team Secret is just content to farm and allow the space to continue.
Yeah, but they need to be careful though. Once IG are able to get a couple of ganks or pickoffs, the whole rhythm breaks. Because when you're doing something like this, you need to make sure you don't die. Otherwise, the whole chain reaction, rhythm is
big
gone.
Engagement, they do go in and they catch Zai. So finally, the elusive Zai is brought down with a big engagement by IG.
Yeah, Disruptor is just one of the better heroes to catch a hero like Ember. So they're gonna have 70 seconds on the Ember, so they can, I guess, try to push high ground with this.
They don't have a lot of choices. They do need to get in there before Secret gets all of their heroes caught back
up. Probably just a tier 2, I guess, because Keeper of the Light is just gonna buy a lot of time.
Buy so much time, and like you said, Ferrari is way up on the lead. He's super fat in terms of farm right now, but he's about to get to that point where he gets diminishing returns, and the four heroes on Radiant who are equally farmed are gonna start to really pull their weight.
And just look at what Chuan is doing. He's constantly doing this, so he knows that Arteezy is always alone trying to speed push. So he was already preemptively at the base rate just to make sure if Arteezy does the same antics he did the last time, he's going to be there to catch him. So they realize what they need to do. They need to catch out the heroes, and they just need to make sure that the rhythm doesn't keep going like this.
And it looks like that's what they're up to. Luo, Ferrari, and FaZe looking to make some moves. Blink in, they catch the Razor. S4 in some trouble, pops the BKB. Can he survive? In comes from the back, comes Burning. His BKB is running. They want to finish off S4. He's dropping low. A couple more will do it. They do manage to get him picked off. A good play by them. And now they've managed to get two kills in the course of about 2 minutes. And after a very long period of nanani boo boo, you can't touch me, they've shown that they can. Meanwhile, up on top, Arteezy and Burning going head to head. Burning gets Yules thrown in the air. The stun's gonna come out. Burning is gonna die. Nice play by Arteezy.
Is he getting out?
No, he does get popped. He's going on Chuan, though. He's not afraid. Wants to go. Chuan's got to back away. Arteezy now on the run. Lots of speed. Going to get glimpsed backwards. This will be the end of Arteezy. And they do finally stop the split pusher.
And all that, and he suicides, and he got a kill on the Bristol.
So he ends up getting the kill, and he suicides. Unfortunate.
Yeah, most importantly, he didn't suicide too early because he was trying to make IG commit more, and his team, again, farming the map. It's just a very good play.
So he does it. He does that. It seems like it ends up being a fair exchange. Oh, looks like the bottom where we see the engagement now on Kurogi. He got out of position, and IG is taking your pickoff strategy to heart and are working hard on it.
This is what happens when they get picked off.
They start to fall apart. The rhythm is broken, and Ferrari is going to push against this Roche very, very aggressively. Is this going to allow them to finally break into that high ground position?
Yeah, this is the, I would say, one of the most important Roshan, because it's the one with cheese as well, so it's going to give them a lot more weapons to push up the high ground, and I'm not sure if they want to get a pipe. Usually against Kotal, you want to get a pipe, but it's already so late, and they don't really have a suitable hero to build a pipe on, so playing without a pipe against a Kotal Blast is very annoying as well. They have to like make sure that they get a pickoff. Remember what they did earlier when they were pushing the tier 1? They smoke behind and they kill the Kotal first before they push. But it's, in this case, it's a high ground, so it's going to be less possible that they do that.
Ferrari does have the Scythe of Ice up, so he's going to go ahead and be able to utilize that. Blinks in, immediately finds Arteezy, hits him with the Hex, follows with the Chase, going to try to do what he can, but Arteezy throws up the Yule Scepter, too tanky. Too fast, too tanky, comes out, but the rest of the group is coming in.
He almost got hit by the Seraphim once, and they would have cancelled the recall.
Puppy and Arteezy playing with fire, but so far it is working out for them. In comes Zai, makes the engagement, goes in, catches Chuan. Chuan in some trouble, jumps away, comes back, sleight of fist, Chuan low, he's gonna drop. Luo now inside, out comes the silence. Will it be enough? No, he's gonna go down, but he has the Aegis, so he's coming back up. S4 gets up the link, wants to go on Burning, pops the BKB, Luo in some trouble, caught behind. In comes Ferrari to try to make the fight happen, pops the ultimate, doing a lot of damage, but he is in the middle of enemy territory. Kuroki now on the run, dropping pretty low. They end up killing Ferrari. Faith now on the run, gets hit with a stun. He is going to go down here as well, and that's going to be a 4-man plus an Aegis for a Witch Doctor.
Yeah, that was they got baited into a really bad position there because they were fighting into a choke point, and the Razor drained a lot of damage and armor from the Shadowfiend. That's why the Shadowfiend dropped so quickly. They were in a really bad position to take a fight, even though, like you mentioned, that Aegis. And did they use the cheese as well?
I believe that they did.
No, cheese is on Undying. So, yeah, it was just a matter of bad positioning. Even though they had Aegis and cheese, it doesn't matter.
Bad positioning, no buybacks on the cores who went down. They're going to start to push in. Arteezy and Zai lay into the middle tower. While up on top, the creeps are going to be pushed up with S4's help onto the top tower. And now we see Zai going down towards bottom. So it's a three-front assault here. You can stop one, but you can't stop us all, as the tactic secret's going for as they start to really lean on these towers. And they may actually get all three.
Divided we stand.
Divided we stand. That is exactly the name. That was secret strategy from the start in this game, and it's working out for him. Arteezy putting a ton of tower damage into here. We already lost the top tower. We're gonna lose the ranged racks down the bottom. We see an engagement that is going to go in on the Ember Spirit. So Zai gets a tower and almost a racks, but ends up going down. He buys back, wants to come back into this. Nice play with the glimpse. Pulls back Arteezy. He's gonna go ahead and get the stomp up. Catches two, but Walrus punch to the face. The heals are too strong. Luo goes down, Bristleback drops, the tombstone means nothing to Zai as he eats his way through it. Buyback from the bristle, and it looks like Secret will disengage at this point. Nice play by Secret, they got in, but it's not over because 430's got the blink. Comes in on Puppy, Puppy dropping pretty low, pops the BKB, but help from Kuroki. Says, you won't kill my Puppy, and instead I will kill your Dirge. And Ferrari on the run, he's gonna go down as well. It's another triple. No buybacks, GG from IG, and Secret plays keep away until they take the racks, break the high ground.
Such well execution on the way they played the game. And yesterday, C9 was doing the same thing, but it wasn't so well executed as how Secret played this game.
So what a game, what a job by Secret to execute perfectly.
It's like a